What does it mean to be spiritual? How does one indoctrinated with a scientific worldview begin to live in a spiritual way? Is it a matter of capturing some feeling or an act of the will or ritual or anything else for that matter?
Yeah, I would say in biblical terms, being spiritual means obedience and aligning your heart, your attitude with God's will. You know, in New Testament terms, it's called discipleship. So being spiritual to me is having the mind of Christ. You know, you look at the mind of Christ, look how that phrase is used in the New Testament. Being obedient to the will of God, aligning one's will, one's thoughts, one's attitudes to what God wants, to God's will. So in other words, it's a decision. It's not a feeling.
Ben also wants to know, what does regeneration really entail and how does it relate to being born again as the first Christians would have understood it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Regeneration is basically to be made new, which is, you know, kind of what the word sounds like. Regeneration is to be made new. It is to be no longer spiritually dead, to sort of state the antonym here. So to be made new, to no longer be spiritually dead, but instead, of course, to have new life. Now, you know, it's not really an either or idea, like either the sinner does something to result in this or God does, you know, and a lot of Christian discussion of this wants to either put it in the hands of the person or put it exclusively in the hands of God. I would say it's a both and. Regeneration is ultimately the work of God, but God requires faith in the mechanism, in the thing that will produce the regeneration, which is, of course, the work of Christ. It's the work of Christ that is the gateway to the new birth. But you're not a beneficiary of that unless you believe. So it's not an either or, it's a both and. Now, Calvinists like to pretend that only God is at work in regeneration. They define regeneration as being enabled to believe. So for instance, in a verse like Ephesians 2:5, you hath he quickened, or you are the one, you hath he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins. Now just think about the wording here. I always have the King James in my head here. Let me just go see how the ESV actually renders this so I don't use the archaic English here. So here's ESV, Ephesians 2:5. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, that God made us alive together with Christ. King James has quickened. You hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. So the Calvinist likes to look at this and they want to see that statement as the first item, the first act, the first thing that happens in a sequence of events. Calvinists like to take words like regeneration, repentance, justification, and make what they call the ordo salutis, the order of salvation. And again, they put regeneration at the front of the line because they want to interpret the term as God enabling you to believe. Well, while you can read it as some sort of initial awakening act, the problem is that this is sort of self-serving to the Calvinistic system, and it's a little bit contrived. The problem is that the exact same words, you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, the same words can be read as an after-the-fact statement of being or a statement of a status. So, okay, you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. Why do I have to read that as the first of a sequential order of events? Why can't I read that as an accomplished fact after the fact? In other words, why can't I read it as a snapshot of the status of salvation, as opposed to, no, it's the first component in a chain of events that lead to salvation? Again, this is just a Calvinistic choice to read it that way. If you actually look up the verb here, it's not a very common verb to make alive in Ephesians 2:5. It's sudzo apoieo, and it only occurs elsewhere in Colossians 2:13, which is the twin epistle to Ephesians. A lot of listeners will know that Ephesians and Colossians are referred to as the twin epistles because their content is so similar, even in the same sequence, you know, of content. And so here's Colossians 2:13, the other reference to this. And you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses. Now you'll notice here that the quickening language is linked to union with Christ. Together with him, okay, union with Christ, It's not linked to some act preceding the union with Christ or that enables the union with Christ. In other words, Paul is describing a divine act that results in a, you know, in being united to Christ. And you say, well, is there a prerequisite to being united with Christ? You know, is there a prerequisite to being, you know, made alive? Well, yeah, there is. There's belief. So Calvinists want to take the reference to the status of being in Christ and then, again, cut it into parts, a sequential order, and then front load the regeneration idea and make regeneration some initial act of awakening. And they do that because it helps make their system elegant and it helps make their system work. But what I'm suggesting is you don't really have to read it that way. And there might be good reason to not read it that way. Just read it as a statement of a new status, of an accomplished fact. Kind of view it as a completed thing rather than a little part of a sequence that leads to the completed thing. So that's how I would approach that whole issue. Again, I think it's a bit self-serving to take one term and a bunch of these terms, you know, used in the New Testament for the new status of the believer and kind of make a, what do we want to call it? An itinerary, you know, the roadmap, you know, some sequential order. But that's what you'll read, you know, in Calvinistic theology, that's where they go with that. The discussion here, before we move on to the next thing, the discussion is related a little bit, and I think the questioner brought it up, to being born again. The word again there is anothen in Greek. It's an adverb that means above. You know, okay, adverbs can denote place. It also can mean again, which is some sort of temporal reference, you know, for the adverb. Now, in passages like John 3:3, unless one is born anothen, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Both of those aspects are in view. Okay, obviously, the above semantic of anothen is in view because, well, that's where, you know, the new birth comes from. That's where regeneration comes from. But Nicodemus, when Jesus says this to them, he's thinking of the temporal idea. Well, how can you be born a second time? You know, so he's thinking of the again, you know, element. But they're both actually present in the language here. So again, is born again? Is that a little point in a linear sequence of events, or does it refer to a new status? Okay, I would say it refers to a new status. I think that's the more natural reading. But again, Calvinists like to take all of the salvation vocabulary and chop it up into a sequence of events because it helps them argue certain points of their system.